over there. Look over there.
It's coming this way. It's definitely coming this way. This is weird.
And they go to enormous lengths to stop us finding out what they know.
People say, don't you worry, they're going to go out before you stand.
Aliens, UFOs, little green men. We all have an opinion.
As I was about to discover, some more bizarre than others.
Excuse me. I'm trying to find out whether people believe in aliens.
Can I? Oh, you can't. Do you believe in aliens? Do you believe in aliens? No. Okay, cheers. Sorry, do you believe in aliens, you guys?
Aliens?
Yeah.
Yeah, I believe there's science out there.
Do you?
Yeah.
Do you believe it can get here?
Depends, but if we can get out in space, why can't we get here?
That's a very good point, and one that I'm not going to argue with. Excuse me? Oh, hi. Do you believe in aliens at all?
We are from Germany.
Oh, right, okay. Does that change things? So do you believe that aliens exist?
I do. I believe that somewhere, not necessarily amongst us,
so you're not entirely sure if they walk amongst us?
I've never met one.
Really?
I can't say I've met one, I'm afraid.
I've only been in Camden 10 minutes, and I'm starting to believe it's true.
Do I believe in aliens?
Yeah.
No, I don't.
You don't at all?
I believe in Jesus Christ, not aliens.
Great. Well, it's been lovely chatting.
Is that it?
Half of us believe in UFOs. One in five of us believe they walk amongst us. So today, I'm going on a journey to find out the truth about UFOs. And I've been told I can find it round here, just behind Marks and Spencer's on Camden High Road in London. Honest. Until recently, this vault was home to our nation's secrets, and I've come here to meet the keeper of those secrets. Nick Pope is Britain's very own Fox Mulder. He works for the Ministry of Defence, and for 3 years he was in charge of the official UFO desk. Tonight, he's going to give us a tantalising glimpse into Britain's X-Files.
If people could see the entire contents of Britain's X-Files, they would, I think, be astounded, and even the most die-hard sceptic would sit up and pay attention.
Britain's X-Files contain cases where UFOs actually invaded British airspace.
There are some spectacular UFO cases that have not yet seen the light of day. Cases where we've got a genuine intrusion into British airspace of some structured craft of unknown origin.
So what does the MOD do about UFOs? Well, nothing, actually. Its policy is simple. If a UFO doesn't pose a direct threat to British security, the MOD doesn't investigate it. The incident is classified and filed away.
Governments don't tend to admit they're in the business of investigating UFOs. To find out why, you've got to come here, to America, the happy, smiling parents of the flying saucer.
Flying saucers have invaded our planet. Washington, London, Paris, Moscow are key targets.
The fictional world of flying saucers had a very real birth. It all began on June 24th, 1947, when a pilot flying across the Cascade Mountains in Washington saw strange objects hurtling across the sky.
And they didn't look like ordinary aircraft, and they seemed to be going at a very, very rapid rate of speed. Now, he happened to know the distance between two particular mountains in that area, and so he calculated the speed that these objects were traveling. Anyway, the speed he calculated initially was at something like 1,700 miles per hour, which was astonishingly fast.
The pilot's name was Kenneth Arnold. When he told his story to a journalist, little did he realize it would trigger a cultural phenomenon.
Every newspaper across the nation has made headlines out of it, and this afternoon we are honored indeed to have here in our studio this man, Kenneth Arnold, who we believe may be able to give us a first-hand account and give you the same on what happened. Go ahead, Kenneth.
They looked something like a pie plate that was cut in half with a sort of a convex triangle in the rear. They seemed to flip and flash in the sun just like a mirror. But to the best of my knowledge and the best of my description, that is what I actually saw, and it's just as much a mystery to me as it is to everyone else who's been calling me the last 24 hours wondering what it was.
The fact is that Arnold, as a witness, had a certain level of credibility. He was a businessman, a very intelligent man. And so Arnold told the press that the objects moved as though they were saucers skipping along the water.
Just as Captain Kirk never actually said the words, "Beam me up, Scotty," and I checked, and he didn't, Arnold never actually said the words flying saucer, but it didn't matter. Flying saucers had entered our vocabulary, cinema screens, and, it seems, our skies.
From out of nowhere, the flying saucer mystery is with us.
Flying saucers were being spotted everywhere by all sorts of people.
What is the flying saucer? What do people see and sometimes photograph? What's behind the daily reports of aerial phenomena in the nation's press?
I glanced up and there were three flying saucers in a V. Approximately a half a mile away from me at an altitude of 350 feet. They appear to be hovering in midair.
America was gripped by the prospect of aliens visiting Earth.
We are your friends. We are your friends. Please contact us.
Some claimed they'd already had contact.
I noticed this little man, the same size of a man, right beside the right side of the hatchway, cooking these pancakes, which I have one here yet. And if that was their food, God help them, because I took a bite of one of them, and it tasted like a piece of cardboard. And if that's what they lived on, no wonder they're small.
And the Air Force wanted to catch one.
Army fighter planes are on patrol for flying saucers.
As sightings increased, so did the mood of alarm. The public feared an invasion of little green men from the red planet Mars. But the military feared a red invasion of a different kind, from America's new Cold War enemy, the Soviet Union.
There was a genuine concern that perhaps these flying saucers were some kind of reconnaissance craft or spy craft that were being sent to basically check out the British Isles and America from the air prior to the forthcoming Third World War.
Tensions were very high. Someone who didn't live through that period often would have a difficult time appreciating the dread, the feeling of dread that many people felt at that time.
Alongside the dread of atomic war, this new terror, the unexplained in the skies. In 1947, paranoia was rife, and the United States primed for its greatest ever UFO story. Roswell.
Anytime people talk about UFOs, the topic of Roswell inevitably comes up. Roswell has become this holy grail for the field of UFO research.
If ufology is religion, Roswell is the holy city. It is the Mecca of the UFO movement.
According to believers, in July 1947, a flying saucer crash-landed outside Roswell. This was one UFO landmark I had to see for myself.
Now, it was round here, somewhere, that farmhand Mac Brazel found some very weird stuff. Very weird stuff that had fallen from up there. Now, this was a man who lived on his own in a tiny hut with no electricity, no phone, and not many neighbours. He was a man unlikely to have heard about flying saucers over Roswell. But without him, then neither would we.
Rancher Mac Brazel was out checking the sheep following a major thunderstorm, came across a large area of debris, something he didn't know what it was. The sheep would not cross that debris.
Assuming the debris was military, Mac Brazel contacted Roswell Air Base. Chief Intelligence Officer Major Jesse Marcel went out to investigate.
He got to look at the stuff and he saw this strange metallic paper, the unusually stiff struts, lightweight materials. But what really got him was the markings that looked like hieroglyphic symbols. They looked like roses and circles and stars and crescents, weird alien looking patterns.
For weeks, the skies had been full of flying saucers. Major Marcel decided there could be only one explanation.
So in the middle of the country's first UFO flap, Marcel saw these alien-looking symbols and said, "We have a flying disc. We were the first. It's the story everyone's obsessed about, and we got it right here in Roswell."
Marcel ordered the airbase press officer to release news of his spectacular find.
Headline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found at Roswell, New Mexico, and is now in the possession of the Army.
The press instantly seized upon the story. But later that day, the U.S. Air Force called a press conference, where, to the astonishment of all, they announced that there'd been a bit of a mistake. What Major Marcel had found was no longer from outer space.
The story goes out that it was all a mistake. It wasn't a flying disc, it was simply a weather balloon. And poor Jesse Marcel had to look like a guy who couldn't identify a weather balloon.
They totally humiliated Marcel. They forced him to be photographed with this crummy weather balloon, and pretty much the Roswell incident died on that day.
This was an age when the media trusted the military. The Roswell story died, though for Mac Brazel, it was still very much alive. What worried him was how long he'd stay the same.
He was told, "You don't say another thing about it." And they took it very seriously. I mean, they live out in the middle of nowhere, literally, and this is a big desert. You can be taken out and not seen again.
We now know that Major Jesse Marcel wasn't fooled by a crashed weather balloon. The debris at the press conference was not the debris he'd retrieved from the Roswell crash site. The real debris had been transported under military guard to Hangar 84 at Roswell Airfield. It would be 50 years before we'd find out what it really was.
It was in this hangar that the debris was stored. The great UFO cover-up had begun, and according to some, it still goes on today. In part two, we'll show how efforts to kill the story had the opposite effect, putting Roswell back on the front pages. Plus, Rendlesham Forest, the day Britain got its very own Roswell. Since the very first official UFO sighting, the CIA, the FBI and the MOD have all insisted they're not interested in UFOs. What we now know is that they were interested. They were very interested. They were so interested that they'd sometimes resort to strong-arm tactics to shut witnesses up. Introducing the Men in Black.
Go, go, go.
So who were the Men in Black? I went to speak to a man who knows.
Now, I'm sure most people will have seen the Men in Black movie, but the film itself is actually based upon real-life existing accounts of people who said they've been visited by so-called Men in Black, literally guys in black suits, ties, sunglasses, black cars, interviewing them or interrogating them, if you like, about their UFO sightings and warning them not to talk about them.
The Men in Black were government agents. Their job? To silence witnesses to UFOs. Trouble was, there were too many credible witnesses, mostly from the military.
If you look back at the 40s and 50s, there are an enormous number of reports filed by qualified pilots, by radar operators, and these people reporting sightings of what seemed to be solid, intelligently controlled machines carrying out incredible maneuvers.
Soon, the incredible was everywhere.
Gee whiz!
Invaders from Mars. He saw them land from outer space. He saw them capture innocent people only to destroy.
In the early 1950s, aliens invaded popular culture.
You'll marvel at the superior intelligence that unleashes its deadly ray.
Then, curiously, reality began to mirror the movies. In 1952, 5 years after the first flying saucer panic, the United States was primed for its second UFO frenzy.
During the summer of 52, you'd have thought an invasion was underway.
In July 1952, thousands of people reported seeing lights and craft over Washington, D.C.
This thing passed over our head, barely above the treetops.
It was hovering over the house, and it was moving side to side directly over this house.
And as far as what it was, I wouldn't have the slightest idea.
The sky is the stage, the actors, so-called flying saucers. And they're back on the scene with some new twists.
Jets were scrambled to investigate. They found nothing. Yet solid objects were being picked up on radar, and the military bombarded with phone calls.
The communication systems apparently were just jammed with telephone calls from a potentially panicked public. There were military analysts who looked at this and said, hey, you know, if something really goes down, if the Soviets want to send missiles over, we're going to be screwed because we'll have no way of responding to this.
Whether these UFOs were real or not, the military had to stop the panic. So it staged its biggest press conference since World War II, where it told the world's media that UFO witnesses were either deluded or dishonest.
We've been able to explain them as hoaxes, as erroneously identified friendly aircraft, as meteorological or electronic phenomena, or as light aberrations.
Just as in the case with Roswell, you get this major media event that disabled the topic, at least in the public mind. It succeeded in what it tried to do.
They'd successfully covered up Roswell. Now they'd quelled the UFO panic of 1952. But America had shown how vulnerable it was to national hysteria. President Truman ordered the Air Force to kill the UFO phenomenon. The result? Project Blue Book.
Ostensibly, it was meant as a project to investigate legitimately UFO sightings and try and determine what they were. But for the most part, it descended really into a public relations operation.
Blue Book really had almost zero in true investigative capacity. I mean, really, during most of its period, it had a couple of people and a secretary. And so how could they truly do an investigation? They had a job to do, and that job was to explain away these sightings.
Blue Book investigators told UFO witnesses that they must have seen a meteorite, the planet Venus, or, as in the case of Roswell, their old favorite, the weather balloon. Facile explanations which failed to kill the UFO phenomenon. So, in 1969, the Air Force shut Project Blue Book. The thinking was, if a UFO sighting isn't officially recorded, then it can't have happened.
By keeping completely stum about UFOs, the US military hoped it would never again be saddled with the slightly embarrassing task of having to actually try and explain them. Over here in the UK, the MOD had always had a UFO policy of no comment. But that all changed in 1980, when news broke of the spectacular events in this Suffolk forest.
There it is again. Yeah, I see it too. Looks like an eye winking at you.
It just moved to the right.
Strange.
I first came across the Rendlesham incident in a way that I suppose any great mystery should come along, via a man in a pub. He'd been working at a radar base in Norfolk, and suddenly along came intelligence officers, both from Britain and America, wanting to take away all the film of the radar that had been captured over a particular weekend just after Christmas.
The officers gave a remarkable explanation as to why they were seizing the tapes.
They said that, in fact, something had come down in Rendlesham Forest and that their airmen had encountered it, and that there'd even been some kind of a communication, allegedly, between one of the senior officers on base and little aliens associated with this UFO.
Back in 1980, the US Air Force had a base near the town of Woodbridge in Suffolk, England. Bentwaters Air Base was a closed community of 10,000 airmen ready to scramble at a moment's notice in the event of a Soviet attack. In December 1980, airmen faced a different threat, one which they could never have prepared for.
A guard patrol spotted strange lights in the forest. Thinking that one of the aircraft had perhaps come down, they asked permission to go off base and investigate. Having obtained permission, they went out into the forest and saw not a crashed aircraft, but a triangular metallic-shaped craft moving through the trees.
And they were watching this strange, smoky, floating object in front of them. The whole air became charged with an electric field. Their hair stood on end, their skins were tingling, and there was a massive crackling charge of energy that was rippling through the atmosphere around them.
The guard patrol actually got quite close to this object. One of the witnesses claimed he got so close he could see hieroglyphs on the side of the craft, and he said that he actually went up and touched its hull.
Next morning, and one of the first to hear this bizarre tale was the airbase's deputy commander, Lieutenant Colonel Charles Holt.
I went up to the desk early in the morning, and the desk sergeant started snickering when I walked in, and I said, "What's so funny?" to him. He said, "You aren't going to believe it." He said, "Last night, three of our security policemen were out in the woods chasing a UFO."
The airman's report provided light relief from the very important job of protecting the world. That was until two nights later.
We were having the annual Combat Support Group Christmas party, and the on-duty flight commander came in, security policeman, and he was just white as a sheet, and he said, "It's back." We said, "What's back?" He said, "The UFO is back."
Unconvinced, Colonel Holt led a group of airmen into the forest to lay the story to rest. He brought with him a pocket tape recorder.
It's looking directly overhead where I can see an opening tree.
This is the actual recording Holt made in the forest that night.
Looks like someone came off about 15 to 20 feet up.
We moved forward and came to a spot where the flight lieutenant told me this is where it had landed.
It's kind of a small blast.
There were three small indentations, all the same size, all the same shape, as though something was sat down on a tripod.
Okay,
get very positive ratings at sea. Is that here the center?
We had the disaster preparedness NCO get the Geiger counter and start taking readings. And he was quite alarmed because he was getting higher readings than normal background radiation. That's when I started getting a little bit nervous, and how did I get into this and what am I doing here? And I noticed off to the side some activity, and the lieutenant started hollering, "Look over there, look over there," and we could see something.
There it is again. What is it?
We don't know, sir.
Looks like an eye winking at you. Still moving from side to side.
It moved through the trees as though it were negotiating a path through the trees, as though it were under some type of intelligent control. The whole time it was appeared to be shedding something like molten metals. It was dripping off it.
It just moved to the right.
Yeah.
Off the right. Strange. Oh, it's coming this way. It's definitely coming this way. There's no doubt about it. This is weird. Now we're observing what appears to be a beam coming down to the ground.
Is this a signal? Is this a warning? Some type of a weapon? What is it? As abruptly as it came on, it clicked off. The object receded. I wanted to get everybody back to the base.
We're turning around, heading back toward the base.
I knew I was going to have to explain what I was doing in the forest all that time, and I really didn't know how I was going to do that and what the reaction would be. I had feelings, well, there's the end of my career.
Except it wasn't. Air Force chiefs believed what Colonel Holt told them and ordered him to put it in a memo. Holt's memo was sent to the MOD and copied to the U.S. Air Force.
The memo was never intended for public consumption. It was never intended to be a final report. The memo was intended to get somebody from whatever department in the MOD to come and properly investigate.
The MOD never replied. Britain's Official Secrets Act would keep Colonel Holt's memo out of the public domain for a minimum of 25 years. Another UFO incident had been successfully contained, or so the MOD thought. By now, UFO investigator Jenny Randalls was on the case.
I sent official letters off here, there and everywhere, trying to get some kind of confirmation that something had happened. And what struck me was not that anybody was denying it, but that they were simply avoiding the question. I got replies back which simply pretended that I'd never even asked that question in the first place. And that made me even more suspicious, because I thought, well, you know, if nothing had happened, all they needed to turn around and say is, it's nonsense, we have no record of this, it didn't take place.
For 2 years, the MOD stonewalled Jenny Randalls. But then, she found a loophole. She used America's Freedom of Information Act to obtain a copy of Holt's memo from the U.S. Air Force. It was the hard evidence UFO researchers had been craving.
It is a report of a landed metallic craft on UK's territory. And Holt's memo makes it clear that there was trace evidence, such as the marks in the clearing where this craft landed, and crucially, the radiation readings that he took at the landing site.
Holt's memo provided the basis for one of 1983's biggest scoops. The story was a sensation.
When the Rendlesham story became front page news, I think it's fair to say the MOD went into something of a panic.
It was just to them one massive publicity headache that they really didn't want to have to face. And they knew they'd be facing questions till kingdom come about what really happened in Rendlesham Forest. And the bottom line is the Minister of Defence know as much or as little about what actually happened as we do.
A quarter of a century on, we're still waiting for an explanation. And the public is left wondering what else the MOD has covered up.
Rendlesham marked a fresh twist in the UFO conspiracy theory. By now, the dark forces intent on crushing the UFO phenomenon had realized it couldn't be crushed. So they tried something new, aiming to infiltrate the UFO movements and manage them from within. The trouble was, they hadn't been expecting the return of Roswell or the arrival of aliens. Right. By the 1970s, the futuristic world of the UFO seemed like a thing of the past. But then, out of nowhere, Roswell was back, this time with aliens. And this was thanks largely to the work of one man, the nuclear physicist Stanton Friedman. And I think he's through here.
So we have one part of the government lying to another part of the government, lying to the public. Now here's where the Air Force really started lying in their Roswell report, fact versus...
I find Stanton, the high priest of ufology, giving a sermon to his flock.
In several instances, we noted the classification top...
It's all a bit over my head.
...several documents. You lie once, you get away with it. You lie twice, you get away with it. You keep lying. Why stop? It works.
I felt a bit out of my depth. A lot of specifics. And I just need to know the whys, basically. The whys and the whats. I tried to ask some questions. There's a lot I need to know. Stanton, I'm Danny. Nice to meet you. Hello, I tracked you down. I'm wondering if I can...
I don't hide.
You don't hide? No, absolutely. You're pretty public. I was just wondering if I can grab a word with you a bit later on or something.
Sure.
When you finish with your slides.
Okay.
I've got some questions.
All right.
Yeah?
I may not have answers, so no guarantee.
That's all right. I may not have many questions either. But we'll see.
You mean I didn't answer them all?
You did.
My piece here today?
Absolutely, but I'm kind of, I was a bit out of my depth, to be honest. It was quite specific stuff, and I just need to know why and what and how and when and things like that, and I think
okay.
You might be the man to talk to.
We'll try.
Yeah? All right, well, I'll hang around. I'll hang around.
Stanton Friedman is the man who, in 1978, resurrected the Roswell case. He tracked down Major Jesse Marcel, the officer who, back in 1947, checked out the debris at the Roswell crash site. Back then, the military said it was a weather balloon. Now, 31 years on, Marcel came clean about what he'd really found at Roswell. It was like nothing he'd ever seen before.
And he told me there were lightweight beams, I-beam shape, you know, with strange symbols along the side, about 3/8 of an inch high. There were some very strong, lightweight, larger metallic chunks. And as Major Marcel told me, you could put one end on a rock, the other on the ground, hit it with a sledgehammer, and you couldn't dent it.
Marcel said that he did see something, and it wasn't from Earth. He didn't know where it was from, but he didn't think it was from Earth.
A decorated war hero claiming he'd found alien debris at Roswell. Marcel's sensational claims formed the basis of the first Roswell bestseller.
That provided the germ that became the phoenix that rose from the ashes to become the best UFO case of all time. And Roswell is now the mecca of the UFO religion.
Suddenly, for UFO investigators all over planet Earth, all roads led to Roswell. Investigators combed the area looking for anyone who knew anything. What they found were witnesses whose claims would shock the world.
Claims not just of a crashed saucer, but of alien bodies inside.
Extraterrestrials were found in Roswell?
Yes.
Dead?
Dead extraterrestrials were found, no question about it.
I believe there were four. One still alive, one that died at the site while the military was there, and two that were dead when the military got there.
They were in the range of 3.5 to 4 feet tall, rather spindly looking, with very oversized heads.
Talking to witnesses, like to the Brazel family, to some of the other people, if they say there were bodies out there that they didn't recognize, that were not human, they were not human.
What actually happened that day in Roswell?
Outside of Roswell, I believe an alien spacecraft crashed. It exploded in midair, spewing wreckage all over the place. A crew compartment, for want of a better phrase, with aliens in it, came down a couple miles away. The government sent people out to clean it up. They've kept it secret ever since, and they've been lying about it quite thoroughly.
But the American public is too smart by half to be fooled by government lies. Honest. A recent poll found that 75% of them believe a UFO crashed at Roswell. The higher that number gets, the better for Roswell. Tourists now flock here. And for Roswell, tourism means money.
If it's alien-related, then you can buy it in Roswell. A life-size, biologically accurate representation of a big blue inflatable alien. A tiny alien playing some kind of space horn. Your very own pickled alien. Each year, over 200,000 people walk away with T-shirts, books, and tiny horn-playing statuettes. An alien top hat and inflatable mallet party set. This is a town that needs its aliens.
I asked the people of Roswell to take me to their leader. I needed to find out if Mayor Bill Owen is a fan of novelty Roswell merchandise.
I'm not a big collector of UFO memorabilia.
You're not? So,
but
why not?
Well, again, I was born and raised here, so I don't think a whole lot about it day in, day out. I see the tourists. I love seeing them come into town because it gives us a chance to show off. And the tourists that come, most of them are just curious.
But what if someone comes around to the Merrill Mansion and they see that you haven't got any alien stuff? Wouldn't that be upsetting for them?
Well, I would rather if they came over to my house. I would rather see them picture of my wife and two kids. That's what I'd rather them
see. That's
what
you'd rather them see?
You bet.
Well, I don't wholly agree with that, so I'm going to sort you out. I hope you haven't got one of these already.
I bet I don't.
That'd be quite embarrassing. hang on. I've actually bought you.
You're right, I do not have one of those.
Well, it's yours now. It's a life-size, biologically accurate representation of a large blue inflatable alien.
All right.
So I'd like you to have this.
Well, thank you.
Whack it in the Merrill home. When tourists come round, it won't be as embarrassing now. You can say, well, look, I've got one as well.
Well, I'll tell you what I've got for you.
Really? The key to the city?
An official City of Roswell pin.
Fantastic.
Well, I appreciate it. Enjoyed meeting you, and I hope you enjoy your stay here in Roswell.
I certainly will. Thank you very much,
Bill. I'll take my friend. Thank you.
See you soon. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Finally, in 1994, after almost half a century of cover-up, denial, and lies, the military decided to tell the truth about Roswell.
We are very, very proud of this report. We think that this answers lots of questions, and it answers them logically and with integrity.
The media was told that the entire Roswell legend could be explained away by a top-secret military operation, Project Mogul. In 1947, Project Mogul had the same top-secret classification as the project to build the first atomic bomb. Mogul's objective? To eavesdrop on the Russians.
We wanted to know if the Russians had the bomb. When did they have it? Where were they testing it? So some clever scientists got the idea of putting sound microphones up in the air, and if the Soviets did put off a nuclear bomb, we could predict where that atomic bomb was tested.
These Mogul balloons were nothing like bog-standard weather balloons. They were high-tech devices packed with gadgets and unusual material. In June 1947, the Air Force lost track of one Mogul balloon. They say it must have crashed in the New Mexico desert, part of it landing outside Roswell.
Well, they took care, you know, when they made these experiments, not to label them top secret U.S. government experiment. So anybody that found these would have found shiny metallic paper with stiff wooden struts that were very hard to break. They would have found eyelets and strings and loops, and all of these things were reported by Roswell witnesses.
And guess what? The Air Force could even explain the alien bodies.
A lot of these reports talked about how the aliens had almost like plastic skin, and they just stared forward with these expressionless gazes.
Quite coincidentally, in tandem with Project Mogul, the Air Force launched Project High Dive, which tested high-altitude parachutes using crash test dummies, which, when you think about it, and you sort of squint a bit, look like dead aliens. So for 50 years, the military had lied about Roswell. It was a conspiracy, and it was a cover-up, but with no flying saucer and no aliens. What they were covering up were top-secret experiments. This has spawned a new theory.
The vast majority of most UFO sightings are probably classified aircraft being developed by the military, and because a lot of them look strange, their first thought is going to be, oh, it's a UFO.
And there is good evidence for this now in the United States that the government have used UFOs as a convenient cover for the testing of some of their new weapons and new aircraft. And even the CIA have admitted that during the 1950s, flying saucers were quite a convenient cover for the U-2 spy plane that they were testing out at the time.
The British military latched onto the idea that a UFO mystery can be a useful smokescreen.
There was an incident in the 1980s where a very sophisticated drone was being test flown over a populated area. When people saw that, because it was a very unfamiliar object, they reported it as a UFO, and the powers that be were very happy with that news, and they allowed that story to develop.
So what about Britain's closest encounter, the Rendlesham Forest incident of 1980?
There is a chance that we were doing experiments involving atmospheric energies, and there were certainly research centres around Rendlesham Forest which were engaged in that kind of research at that time.
So, if I believe what I'm told, UFOs are actually just military tests and experiments, and that would certainly seem to explain why so many of them happen near military bases, and it would also seem to explain why since the end of the Cold War there's been such a sharp dip in the number of sightings, you know. I guess we're just not testing as much as we used to test up there. And for the military, it's a perfect cover. They can keep their secret tests pretty much a secret. Or maybe that's just what they want us to think.
No way. There's no sale here. There are UFO reports that are up close and personal by very, very smart and intelligent, knowledgeable people who are seeing disc-shaped objects, stopping, silent, taking off, making no radius turns and the like. And you're gonna tell me that's a U-2, well, that's your problem, not mine. So that, there's something much more going on here.
Some UFO investigators cling to the notion that we've been visited from outer space. But could this conviction be motivated by more earthly considerations?
Ufology is big business. Once you get onto this international UFO lecture circuit, you travel around the world, you go on cruises, you know, there's lots of money to be made, let's face it, and, you know, you've got to hand it to him.
Forget the Starship Enterprise. As I discovered on the UFO lecture circuit, private enterprise is the name of the game.
Some great stuff here, just DVDs and everyone's evidence. This one's called What's in the Basement of the Secret Empire. I'm imagining probably a couple of old bikes, some charcoal, stuff like that. Charlie Hill story. I really hope this is a musical. This is what I'm talking about. Conspiracies. Facts, hopefully. No pictures.
Stanton Friedman gets, I think, you know, hundreds of dollars for his lecture, Flying Saucers Are Real. He's got books. They've all got books. I can't make a living on my lecture, Flying Saucers Are Not Real. It's just not that interesting. It's hard to get 1,000 people to pay to see your lecture. Roswell is all bunk.
Right. This might seem a bit weird, but having been in there, I've kind of got a new way of thinking. I've got a new aspect on it. Now, when we think about who would benefit from the great UFO conspiracy theory, we kind of think of the government or the military or the secret dark forces who are pulling the strings. And we forget that actually these people are benefiting as well. You know, careers are being made in there. Celebrities are being born. Everyone's got a book to sign, a book to sell. Everyone's got a world tour of speaking engagements, a DVD. And the irony is that if this was solved overnight, if aliens landed on the White House lawn and we all knew for a fact that UFOs existed, these people would lose out. You know, careers would be lost. So maybe this is a conspiracy theory in which everyone benefits.
Over on Sky Cinema One, shortly, Robert De Niro faces the...